Hi, and welcome to one of a series of videos about the Great Conjunction, this time hosted by Exeter Science Centre. I'm Dr. Alice Mills, one of the founders of Exeter Science Centre, working to create a STEM discovery centre in Exeter. On the 21st of December this year, Jupiter and Saturn are going to appear closer in the sky than they have for 400 years. These two giant gas planets and some of their larger moons are going to be visible, hopefully, within the same field of view of the same small telescope. This is a really rare and beautiful sight, and hopefully, weather permitting, something that we can all enjoy. Professor Matthew Bate from the University of Exeter will be talking in another video about exactly how you can observe this event. But today we want to think about the planets themselves. So we're really lucky to be joined by Professor Nathan Mayne and Dr. Stephen Thompson from the University of Exeter, who are both specialists in different aspects of the climates of other planets. So firstly, Nathan, thank you so much for joining us. If you could just start by introducing yourself and tell us a bit about your research.
So my name is Nathan and I work at the University of Exeter in the astrophysics group, and I study the climates of distant planets, particularly what are called exoplanets. Those are planets we've discovered orbiting distant stars. The main aim is to try to work out if any of those planets have a climate that might be able to host life, and of course eventually detecting if life does actually exist on those planets.
Brilliant. So Jupiter and Saturn should be fairly familiar to most of us, but what's special about them? How do they compare to Earth, for example?
Yeah, they're really wonderful sights to see, and I'm sure everyone that's watching this would have seen a picture of Jupiter or Saturn. They are very, very different from Earth, about 10 times the size of Earth, for example, Jupiter is. Also very, very cold, maybe minus a few hundred degrees. The one big difference as well, which sort of shapes a lot of what you see when you look at Jupiter, is how fast it's rotating. Jupiter is rotating once every 10 hours, which is really quick for something 10 times bigger than Earth. And what you see when you look is banding of the clouds that are formed, which is caused by this really fast rotation.
Are planets like this rare, or do other planetary systems around other stars have planets like this?
Well, so planets in and of themselves are incredibly common, in fact. And whenever we have the sort of ability, technically speaking, to find one, we usually find a planet. So we think now that every star you see in the night sky, on average, will have one or two planets. So planets themselves are very common. In terms of the question of whether Jupiter and Saturn itself are very common, their particular size and position, we'll have to wait a little bit longer for the answer to that. We certainly find a lot of Jupiter-sized planets, but they're easier to find if they're a bit closer to their parent star, a bit hotter, a bit puffier. And we also find them when they're very young, and actually when they form, they're very, very hot as well. So we can find those. We do still think that planets like Jupiter and Saturn, the same sort of distance from their star, are common, but we don't know, and they're a little bit harder to detect at the moment.
Great, thank you. So silly question now. Do you have a favourite gas giant?
My favourite sort of type of planets, more of a type rather than an individual one, are planets called hot Jupiters. And they were the first planets we discovered orbiting a sun-like star. And they're really fascinating because they're just like Jupiter in many ways. They're really big. They're sort of these gas giants. But they're incredibly close to their parent star, closer even than Mercury is to the Sun. And there are all sorts of amazing things that happen. We find some of them where the atmosphere is just evaporating, essentially kind of boiling off. They're also rotating really slowly. They're what's called tidally locked, just like the Moon and the Earth. So the same face is always facing the star. There's a hot side and a cold side. And what this leads to is the jets on Jupiter. Very similar situation, but this time they're huge. Rather than bands across Jupiter, you'd see, if you could look at a hot Jupiter, you'd see just one big band. And that makes them really fascinating and quite kind of unique laboratories to understand how atmospheres work.
So what's your research specifically about?
I use models that are used to understand Earth's climate. So the UK Met Office uses a sort of big piece of software, really, that models the Earth's weather to give us weather prediction, but also the longer term changes in climate. And what we do here at Exeter is, as a large group of us, we've adapted that code and also kind of made our own pieces of software too, and tried to really model not so much the weather, but the kind of bulk climate, the average conditions that we might find on planets elsewhere. Now, that may sound a bit far-fetched, but we have quite a lot of observational information. So when planets, for example, move in between their star and us, some of the light comes through the atmosphere, and that can tell us things like the temperatures or what gases are in those atmospheres. And even in a couple of cases, we can actually get tentative measurements of the wind speed in these atmospheres. So there's quite a lot of information for us to use in our software to try and simulate what that climate might be like.
That's awesome. Sounds really cool. So for a lot of people, they probably can't imagine what a modern day astronomer actually does day to day. Can you give an idea what it actually means to be an astronomer?
Right now, spending a lot of time on Zoom calls. So given the current situation, there's a lot of communication. I guess the career as a whole, with research in particular, the really exciting part of it is you're constantly asking new questions and trying to understand things that we don't understand. That has its negative side. It makes you constantly feel a bit unintelligent, I guess, because you don't know the answer to the questions. But that tells me you're asking yourself the correct questions. Day to day, working in research is a lot about, at least in the way I do it, communicating with PhD students or masters and undergraduate students, and then people who work at a level called postdoctoral researchers, and working with them on the projects, either computer programming or working with telescopes to try and obtain data. So a lot of it is still actually sort of teamwork in a way, and working in larger teams to try to sort of answer these big questions. If you work at a university, that's also combined with, of course, teaching, which is really important, and really the research and the teaching are linked in many ways. And then, of course, sort of general jobs at the university to keep it running. So it's a very varied job, actually.
That's been brilliant. Thank you so much, Nathan. Nathan is really no stranger to communicating his research, and he's done some fantastic outreach. Some of it you can see online, some of the virtual resources he's prepared. So please do visit his webpage on exoplanetology.com. And thank you so much, Nathan. Make sure you visit the University of Exeter's Great Conjunction webpage and sign up to hear when they will be live streaming the event from their telescopes. If you want to hear more about Exeter Science Centre and the work that we're doing, then please visit our webpage, exetersciencecentre.org, and follow us on social media. Thanks for watching!